Mark Norman is a New York City-based comedian who has made an appearance on nearly every late-night show, including Conan, four times?
Oh, yeah.
He's been seen on Showtime's Live at South by Southwest, Inside Amy Schumer, Last Comic Standing, Comedy Central's Half Hour at Midnight. He released an album with Comedy Central Records titled Still Got It. And last Friday at midnight, Mark's first hour-long special premiered on Comedy Central. It's called Amy Schumer Presents.
Nah.
Mark Norman, don't be yourself. Along with comedian Joe List, he co-hosts the podcast Tuesdays with Stories, which my producer Alex loves more than this podcast,
well,
which
thanks,
I really
Al.
Resent. I'm on the subway, blowing a guy. I look up, and there's you, a big poster.
Huh?
Don't be yourself.
Oh, boy.
I choked on the, the sperm. How does that feel, seeing your face, your body?
It's pretty wild. I mean, just as a guy who, you know, came up in New York with nothing and struggled for years and all that, it's and seeing other people like Louis and Chris Rock's and all these people in the subway, I was always like, I could never have that. Then eventually you start seeing your friends, like Michael Che had one and Dan Soder and Big J, and then you're like, wow, that's cool, they have one. And then when you have one, it doesn't really register.
Mm-hmm.
I stood next to one yesterday, and people walked by and went, you know, that's me, and nobody stopped. That's New York, baby. That's why New Yorkers are funny.
Are you being recognized?
Every now and then I get recognized, mostly for the podcast, or if I'm just off, like I did Fallon on Thursday, and I had people the next day going, were you on Fallon? Was that you?
Wow.
So that's fun.
Do you like that?
I like a quickie. I was with a girl recently in Columbus Circle, and we were on a date, and this guy goes, oh, you're funny as hell. I saw your special. And I think that was a great, because he just kept walking.
Mm-hmm.
But that's part with the girl, you know, I'm getting, that's a definite get laid move.
Is it a get laid move?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I didn't ask this guy to say anything, and he came to me, and he kept moving. It was perfect.
Does she change once you get recognized?
Yes.
You notice that, or do you change?
I change and she changed. She goes, oh, my God, does that happen a lot? Wow, that was so cool. Do you know that guy? Who was that guy? I'm like, I don't know, just a fan, I guess. And the whole mood is different.
The mood is different. Do all women respond that way? Because I would think if I were a woman, and I don't understand women.
Sure.
But you do.
Some.
You do. You do understand women. I would think, all right, I'm walking with this guy. He's a big star. I just discovered he's really famous or, you know.
I mean, big star and really famous.
Yeah.
Generous.
What's he doing with me? And he can have any woman. So he's going to sleep with me and then treat me like crap. And he's going to be on to the next.
I think you went a little dark.
That should be the name of this podcast.
Yeah.
we were doing so well.
Yeah.
And then I go, but don't women, why wouldn't a woman think I'm with Mark Norman?
Yeah.
He seems like a nice guy. He's funny. I'd like to settle down with him. I think mm-hmm. his sperm is good.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he could make good, smart, funny babies.
Sure.
Oh, he's famous. He can probably have any other woman in the world. So he's going to dump me. He's just going to use me as a sperm receptacle.
Uh-huh.
Do women think that way?
I think some do, but I think in that moment with the fan, I think they're going, oh, I made a good choice here.
Are they turned on by power? Are you saying that they want something that is strong?
I think there's a million zillion dudes out there, and if you can come out on top in any way, it helps. And I think with a fan walking by and going, hey, that was fun, I think that gives them a boost of like, all right, I'm with the right guy for a second.
Are you having fun? Do you like...
I'm trying. It's hard. I'm a mess.
You're part of the machinery right now.
Yeah, I know. That's scary. I'm in the cog. I'm a cog in the system.
But is it exhausting? Is
it
scary?
It's scary. It's scary that it's all going to go away. It's mm-hmm. all catch-22s all day long. All you want is success. All you want is respect. And then when you get it, you're stressed out and you want it to go away. And then when it goes away, you want it back.
Mm-hmm.
And then it comes back again. And it's a ton of work. And I hired a publicist and then she ran me ragged. And, you know, the whole thing is coming down on top of you. And then it all goes out in the world. And people critique it and tell you what they think. And they give you feedback. And that's scary, but sometimes great and sometimes painful. So it's a nonstop emotional roller coaster. And I'm on the front seat of it right now.
But it's you. It's your art.
Yes.
In other words, you're not on a sitcom. You're not promoting a piece of crap. You're promoting something that you deeply care about.
That's true. That's true. I don't want to...
You're not ashamed of this.
No, I actually like it, but I'm still scared of people's thoughts. That whole thing, like, I don't care what other people think. I desperately care what people think, and I live by each comment.
Yeah. Yeah. I know how you feel.
Yeah. If I'm being... And I read the bad ones, too. I'm not one of these guys who reads and goes, fuck this guy.
I only read the bad ones.
Well, that's all you get. No. But, I read the bad ones and I go, hey, he's got a point. I was talking too fast. Or, hey, he's got a point. I made a weird gesture there. You know, I don't, if it's some guy's like, look at this douche, I'm like, all right, well, that's not helping me.
What about the haters?
Yeah,
well,
they're just dead inside and need a reaction. And,
but
you
so
know.
Are we.
Yeah, that's true. But at least we're coming up with something creative. He just called me a douche.
Have you ever converted a hater?
I have. Ironically, if you come at them with some decency, they kind of pull back. Because I think they just want a reaction more than anything.
Uh-huh.
You know, so if you go, hey, I'm sorry you feel that way, they go, ah, shit, man, I'm sorry. I didn't know you were listening. I'm the worst. I'm gay. I hate myself. And you're like, all right, no problem. I hate myself, too. And now you're friends.
So you did Fallon.
Yes.
Have you done The Tonight Show before?
First time debut.
Little nerve-wracking, not necessarily because it's Fallon, not because it's The Tonight Show. It's going into that building.
Yes.
It's
30 Rock.
It means it's freighted, right?
It's the top of the heap as far as late night goes. And, you know, you got the suit on. And I already feel weird about that. It's in the middle of the day, so you've had enough time to get anxious and hate yourself, you know? and I slept 2 hours the night before. I just couldn't sleep. I took 11 melatonin, and I still couldn't sleep. That's how wacky and churning my brain was. It was a real carnival up there. And, yeah, I just had to drink a cup of coffee, which I never do, and suck it up and go. And I had my agent there, my manager, and my publicist, and three friends. And I told my agent and publicist and manager, I sent him a group text saying, don't ask me how I'm feeling. Don't ask me if I need anything right now. Don't ask me if I'm good or if I'm ready or if everything's cool. That's going to make it worse.
We're talking with Steve Harvey. He's the host of Family
You're the
Family
second guy
Feud.
To say that. What did he do?
He did what any normal man would do. Get the F out of my dressing room.
Well,
Right?
They fuck your head up. It's way worse because they need to feel needed. They don't really give a shit about how you're feeling or if you need anything. They just want to justify the fact that their job is pretty easy. And they want to feel needed. And if I go, I need some water, they give me the water. They're like, all right, I'm here. I'm helping.
Right.
So
they
want to
help, but they want to be a part of it.
Yes.
And they're looking out for you, but they're also looking out for themselves.
Yes, which I get. And they're not bad people, but I'm just saying, for my headspace and my where I need to be, don't ask me this shit. It'll only make it worse.
How old are you? 32?
33.
You're doing The Tonight Show. You're waiting in the wings.
Yes.
33, Tonight Show, it's not make or break. It's make. It's make. In other words, if you do well, that's great.
Yeah.
If you don't do well...
Yeah, it's a bummer.
It's a bummer. It's a disappointment.
But I'm not out of the business.
But you're not out of the business.
So it's not a bad place to be.
Right. You're standing in the wings. They're about to introduce you. Heart pounding?
Yes.
Bullet points?
Yes.
You use bullet points.
Why not? If they're there, if they're going to let me do them, I'll use them.
That makes it a lot easier.
Oh, yeah. And I had a brain freeze out there on my second
joke.
Wow. And thank God those bullets were there, baby. It was a real brain queef, I'd say. It wasn't even a fart.
Because in the old days, they didn't let you use.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Why not? What is it hurting?
They felt, I don't know, Mark Malkoff maybe could answer this. He does that Carson special or podcast.
Oh,
I know that,
that
Letterman felt that giving the comedians bullet points, I don't know. Show business shouldn't be that easy for you. You should be nervous.
Yeah, I guess. But, I mean, I say why not? I mean, I guess,
agree with you.
Yeah, a comic could be seen reading them maybe, but it's one word. I don't know. You're in, you're out.
I guess their feeling is you're...
You should know it.
You should know
it. It's like cheat sheet kind of thing.
But the brain freeze... That is absolutely terrifying.
Oh, my God. You have to have it's a real fight or flight moment going, hey, your brain's going, oh, shit, what's next, what's next? We're on The Tonight Show, the cameras, this is it, you're blowing it, ah! And then the other side goes, fuck you, motherfucker. Snap into it, quit being a pussy, no time for this bullshit. It's like a drill sergeant and a new cadet. You're like, I can't go over that wall. And he's like, you're going over that wall, faggot, you know, so... So and that happens in a matter of a millisecond.
Right. So it's right, but it feels like 3 days.
Yeah.
Did you use the bullet points? Did you look at the cue card?
I did for that joke only. But after that, I was smooth sailing. But it was that beginning moment. That's when the first joke I got out clean. The second joke I was like, "What's next? Oh fuck!"
So when you watch, have you watched it?
No. I can't. I don't need to watch.
Would you notice the stumble? Is there a stumble?
I would, yeah. If you put it on right now, I'd be like, there it is. And I bet you could see it, but the public couldn't. The masses, they missed it.
You're walking out.
Mm-hmm.
You tell your first joke.
Yeah.
How'd the first joke go?
First joke went okay.
Now, what do you think? Okay, the first joke went okay. What are you thinking?
I remember thinking, well, that was okay. It wasn't amazing. You want to just blow the roof off immediately.
So you're making the mistake, as I've been told,
uh-huh,
which is counting the laughs. You're not supposed to do that.
Yeah, I hear that, but I can't help it.
Yeah.
How could you not? You want to do well. You want to be in charge of how it's going.
So when did the brain freeze start?
After the first joke.
Oh, yeah.
So there you go. That's wow, it. You know your comedy, because these are good questions.
So the brain freeze starts, you tell the second joke.
I tell the first one, I get a laugh, then I get the freeze.
Oh, wow.
So it's before the setup of the second joke.
Okay, that's messed up.
Yeah. It was bad.
And how much preparation did you do for the set?
I ran it every night for about a month and a half.
Jesus.
Yeah, and
that's
multiple
beautiful.
Times a night.
Yeah.
I mean, I knew this was the big wig, you know, Fallon, Tonight Show, so I had
right.
to be crisp. And I was tweaking it throughout.
Yeah. It's diamond cutting.
It is. It really is.
It's thrilling. It's because it's precise, mm-hmm, and it's absolute control.
Yes. And you run it in a bar room, you run it in a club, you run it in a theater, you run it in a, you know, a backyard, whatever. You know, just run it every single weird place you can because, oh, it went differently here. All right, like take that in. Oh, it went differently there. Okay. So mm-hmm. you just keep melding it, you know, like a
right.
samurai sword, as Louis would say. You keep hitting it until it's a perfect, you know, smooth steel.
Yeah. All right, and then so you freeze.
Yeah.
Was that from exhaustion, from lack of sleep?
Nah, it was, I think, anxiety-induced.
Yeah.
It was it was all coming crashing down. Like, the first joke I got out, because all you have to do is go, okay, I'm here now, tell a joke. And then I'm like, wait, I'm here. I'm on stage. I'm in the Tonight Show. I'm in 30 Rock. I'm on Studio B. Ah! That's when it all hit me, and that's when I've had the freeze, when I had to go, hey, get back into it, buddy. Come on, snap in there.
No human being in their right mind puts themselves through that. I have a friend who did Letterman when he was your age,
mm-hmm,
when it was late night.
Yeah.
You know, at 12:30. They bumped him the first time because he was freaking out.
Really?
Yeah, and they brought him back and he did it. And I remember standing in the wings waiting to do a show with my heart beating, mm-hmm, and being really nervous.
Yeah.
Thinking, this is the ultimate invasion of my privacy. I'm in TV Guide. I hate this.
Really?
I hate this. People are going to see me on TV Guide. They're going to tune in. They're going to be rooting against me.
Yeah.
Why am I doing this? And I'm waiting to be introduced.
Yeah.
And I had this epiphany. I thought, oh, that's why my friend never got back on television. He didn't want this.
Mm.
He won't admit to himself. He won't admit to himself that he doesn't want this, but this is unnatural.
Yeah.
This is not the right way. So you better make a decision right now, pal.
Yeah.
Do you want this?
Right.
And I went out there and I did okay.
Good for you.
Yeah, I mean, because it was kind of thinking, yeah, I want this. And this is what separates us from, there are other funnier guys.
Yeah.
They just don't want to go, they don't want to put themselves through this.
And that's totally fine.
Yeah.
Is this on YouTube? I'd like to see this.
The
set.
What was a Conan shot?
Oh, it was a Conan. Is that on YouTube?
Maybe. I'd have to go search it.
All right, we got to get that up. Whoever's got that on VHS.
Yeah. I was always having a nervous breakdown before I went, but I put myself through it.
Yeah.
I would insist on, Dave Cyrus has walked in with
his
laundry. I do people's laundry.
Oh, nice.
Hey, Dave Cyrus.
Hello. Hello. It's not laundry. Just some things I need.
Uh-huh. Looks like a pillow of some kind.
So Dave Cyrus is going to be my wingman today because I think I'm going to have sex with you.
Oh, great.
I'm going to move over here. Why don't
we
take a quick break? And when we come back, we'll be joined by Dave Cyrus and Mark Norman. Mark Norman is here. Dave Cyrus is here. And we're talking with Mark, his new Netflix special.
Comedy Central.
Well, it's going to be on Netflix.
I don't think so. I hope one day. Please put it on there.
Yeah, but watch it on Comedy Central. It's Amy Schumer Presents, Mark Norman, Don't Be Yourself. Opening for Amy. Amy is so generous with other comedians.
She's a giver.
She really is. And she's not threatened at all. You've opened for Louis. You've opened for all these guys. Do you blow them off the stage or do you blow them under the stage?
No. I mean, those people are there to see Amy or there to see Louis or whoever the hell I'm opening for. So I've done some good shows in front of Amy when she was like a smaller comic at a comedy club. But if it's at an arena where she does shows now, they're there to see her. So there's no way I could ever blow her off the stage.
Are you holding back?
I'm not holding back, but I'm definitely I'm setting the table. That's my job as an opener. Set the table and make it good for the headliner.
Somebody told, Dennis Miller said to me when I opened for him. Do you remember Dennis Miller?
I'm a huge, Black and White, I think, is one of the best specials ever, and no one talks about it.
Yeah. Yeah. Boy, he still makes me laugh. It breaks my heart. The politics are so... Yeah.
It's a bummer.
Sorry. I'm sorry you're in so much pain.
Oh, it's okay.
Your body feels like my brain.
Go along with your conversation.
Okay.
I'm just going to...
Mark Norman, we're talking with Mark Norman. And so Dennis had me open for him a couple of times.
That's very flattering.
And I said, I'm not going to blow you away. I'm setting the plate.
Yeah.
I'm setting the table for you. Blow me away. That's what you're supposed to do. Give me everything you got.
Hmm.
I go, it's not a competition. He goes, yes, it is. Give me everything you got.
Whoa.
I said, if I give you everything I got, I will poison this crowd. And he goes, you think you're that funny? I said, no. I just know they'll walk out. But he said to me when he was starting out, his goal was to blow the headliner off the stage. And I thought, well, that's revealing about your character and your politics. So you do hold back for somebody. Would you feel, have you ever found yourself thinking, wow, I'm doing too well, I better pull back here?
Well, again, I'm only doing maybe 15 or 20 minutes. So they're doing an hour. So it's their show. So even if I kill it, because I have short jokes and everything, I could really murder, but I don't think that 10 minutes or 15 minutes or 20 minutes is enough to where they go, well, we're good now. Mm-hmm. We've seen our show. Because it's only a two-man show.
Yeah.
So I don't think... I mean, I've blown some comics off the stage. I don't want to say I haven't. But
that, do you feel good doing that or bad?
I just feel like, hey, I'm doing my thing. I don't see it as like, I'm going to blow this guy out. I just go, hey, I fucking killed. That was a good set.
Right.
You have fun. Ride the wave.
I think the Marquis de Queensbury rule of opening for somebody is... don't talk to the audience.
Yes, that's a rule you should, I think uphold.
You know, if I would say you can try to blow me off the stage, just don't talk to the audience. In other words, do your material. Do your act.
I agree.
But what if you're a host feature? What if you're the first person to walk up on that stage?
Don't want a little bit ideally.
Engagement?
I'm always the first. I never do it.
You don't talk
to
the audience.
I don't really either.
That's interesting. See, that, I think, is one of my problems with the New York comedy scene is everybody's fast, everybody's quick, and everybody can talk to the audience, but it gets the audience in the mood to be part of the show.
Yeah, yeah.
And you're a joke writer.
I'm all joke. I don't want to talk to them.
Right.
I could, but I don't want to.
And do you think because you don't talk to the audience, so many people want you to open for them?
I think that might be part of it, yeah. But yeah, I'm a joke guy. I mean, if anybody went out on Louis' show and was like, hey, buddy, where are you from? Where'd you get that shirt, homo? He'd be like, ugh, fuck this guy.
Right.
You know, so I don't do it.
Why do you hate Jews so much?
I love Jews. I'm exactly the opposite. My website has a section called Jews. I want to be a Jew. I'm just a wannabe.
Are you mistaken? List?
Is it just a list?
Just a list.
Yeah.
Photos.
Are you mistaken for a Jew?
A lot, yeah.
Do you like being mistaken?
That's
for
a huge compliment. You guys are killing. You're 6% of the country, and you run everything. I think a lot of the Jew haters just shame. People go, oh, man, those guys are fucking killing it.
I don't know if we run everything.
Well, I mean, that's an exaggeration, but you're doing pretty well.
I don't know if that's true.
Well.
I think the Irish Catholics.
I don't see a lot of homeless Jews.
Okay. I'm a renter.
Do you? Well, that's what I'm saying. A homeless Jew is a renter.
I think that's, you know, like in the comedy writing rooms, there are not that many Jews. It's mostly Irish Catholics.
You think so?
Oh, yeah.
Hmm. I thought it was mostly Jewish.
I was at the Writers Guild Awards. Were you there? You go through the names. I pay attention to the names. It's not that. So
and you got the Lampoon guys.
Yeah, but then get the list of of New York slumlords.
Yeah, exactly.
And it is like a comedian trying to make a list of funny Jew names.
Right, Shlomo, Schmeagle.
It's all like the completely non-Americanized.
Right.
You were definitely born in another language.
Yeah.
So let's talk about the theme of your podcast. You're a storyteller or not?
Yeah, I like
with
to
jokes.
Spin a yarn, yeah.
But you hang jokes. Which come first, the jokes or the story?
Well, I guess when I was a kid, it was story because you had to just say something. This happened to me. How crazy is this? And then you pepper in jokes. You go, oh, that got a laugh. And now they're listening better. So maybe I'll just keep doing that.
Stories first, then jokes.
Yeah, jokes are harder, I think.
Do you come up with a story that you jot down on a cocktail napkin, or is it always the jokes you jot down?
The jokes I jot down. Stories up here because I lived it. The joke you have to actually craft.
And would the joke stand on its own without the story?
Yeah, if it's good enough, yeah.
When you're doing Fallon, when you got to get it down to 5 minutes, what do you sacrifice more, the story or the jokes? What
story.
Do you...
It's all joke.
It's all joke.
All joke. There's zero story. My opening joke is, it's quick. It's, I drink too much. I actually got fired from a job for being drunk at work. My boss said, hey, it's clear you're a high-functioning alcoholic. And I go, geez, how do you know I was high? You know? And the only story part is that I got fired.
Uh-huh.
So that's the story. So I'm taking the littlest amount I can do of the story to make it a joke.
And how much of these stories are absolutely true?
Maybe, on the podcast, 100%.
100%.
But in the act, maybe 60%.
Do you feel you're cheating the audience if you change the story to make it funnier?
No, I think I'm helping them. No, I think I'm doing them a service. It's like that Dom Herrera joke. People go, true story. I don't care if it's true. Make it funny. Who cares how true it is? Yeah.
Does the audience know it's not true? Or do they think it's true?
They probably think it's true, but that's my choice to you get what I'm spitting out.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. 100% honesty on the podcast.
Yes.
What's the difference between a Netflix? I keep saying it. I apologize for Netflix.
It's fine. I don't care.
It's Comedy Central. I apologize. Same, you know, but both are.
It's an hour.
It's an hour. What is the difference between doing, getting an hour special for Comedy Central ready and your stand up? Are you sacrificing story for the Comedy Central special?
Yeah, again, I'm not a big story guy, except for the podcast. That's a lot of stories. But the hour is just joke. I don't want any air. I don't want any fat. Just punches.
And are you taping every set in preparation?
Taping them all and changing the order and trying new tags and taking tags out that aren't working. And then, there's, you know, you do an hour. There's always a couple jokes that don't get what you want. So you're focusing a lot on those. And then what's going to go first? What's going to go last? You know, so.
And are you able to crack why a joke doesn't give you what you want?
Usually I can crack it. Sometimes it'll take years. Sometimes you're in the shower scrubbing your asshole and you go, that's it! And then sometimes you never get it. And then, you know, you kind of have to just let it go.
Are there some jokes that only work in front of a specific audience?
Yes.
Because in a club, maybe the men or the women are afraid to laugh because it reveals too much about their character.
Sure.
So that if you do it on your special, millions of people will laugh.
Yes.
Because they're alone.
Exactly.
But they don't want to be revealed.
So that just true. Sounds like something you tell yourself when your joke bombs.
Sure. But I mean, if you focus group it over and over and over at different places, you can get a gauge on that. Like I have a joke about cheating. And if it's a date night, Saturday night, and I see a lot of couples, the joke gets kind of like a, because I think a lot of guys have been caught cheating.
Uh-huh.
Or a lot of girls assume the guys are cheating. So that gets awkward. But like singles night or somewhere else, maybe at a comedy club on a Wednesday with a bunch of nerds in there, kills.
Right.
Because the joke is good, but I think it hits home a little bit.
So are
dates.
Your ears primed for this?
Oh, yeah. I'm all ears. Ear to ear.
And so you know that a bit... I would think bits about one night stands with women and stuff would reveal way too much about the men or the women in a club, but home alone, they're going to love this stuff.
Maybe. Yeah, I'm fine with that. I'll still do it.
What about how dark the room is?
I like a darker room.
Why?
I just think people get self-conscious with the lights on.
Right.
And to go back to your old question, some crowds getting in, some crowds... I have a whole chunk on anxiety, and if I'm in the Midwest, they're kind of like, who cares? What? Anxiety? Go to work, you know? But if I'm in New York or L.A., they're like, yeah, I feel you, brother.
Uh-huh.
So that was an interesting interesting takeaway.
You suffer from anxiety.
Big time.
Yep. Join the club.
Yes, I figured. That's why I love Jews. You guys get it.
We not only get it, we give it. Now, I have been told that anxiety is powerlessness. It's a complete lack of power.
Is that right?
That's what I was told.
That makes sense. A lot of fear.
A lot of fear, not having control.
Mm-hmm.
My big anxiety is I'm all alone.
Mm.
That I'm going to die alone. And then I realize everybody dies alone.
That's true. I'd rather die alone. I don't want to die in a group. But yeah, I think I don't have that. I like being alone. So my anxiety is just people disliking. Which I guess is similar.
Anxiety being disliked?
Disliked.
You care about what people think of you. You said
yeah,
that earlier.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, and yet you have no filter. You'll say whatever you want.
That's me just going, fuck you, body. I'm just doing this. It's a little bit of a rebel against the wanting to people like me.
You want people to like you.
Yeah,
you
my
want
dad,
people to love you.
My dad's very unlikable.
Mm-hmm.
I hope he never hears this because he thinks he is. But and I think I'm just always like, I don't want to be that. That's so scary.
How important is love to you? This is one of the things I've discovered because I'm single.
Mm-hmm.
Married for before you were born.
Mm-hmm.
I knew that I was doing comedy because I wanted to be loved.
Interesting.
That I need love. I need to be loved. I will take it. I'll take fake love. I'll take real love. I'll take the love of a cat, a dog, a wife, a kid. I'll take, you know, a cleaning lady who loves me because I give her work. I mean,
sure,
anybody, you know, just and I remember checking into the Four Seasons Hotel in Chicago, and I wasn't paying for this.
Yeah.
I'll talk about mooching in a second.
Oh, please.
But I remember calling my family up and saying, this isn't love at the Four Seasons. It's close enough. This is just as, you know, I'll take paid love, whatever.
Yeah.
I don't know how many comics from your generation are desperately seeking to be loved.
I think it's in there. I think more than you think.
You're the first young comic I've met who has admitted that he wants to be liked.
Yeah, sure. I think they're all full of shit.
But do you talk about that with the other comics? You're
33. I guess I don't. No.
Because you're the first one, and you did the show about 2 years ago, and I didn't discuss this with you, and I never got this from you. Is this a new thing that you're admitting to yourself? Because I never picked up from you that you want to be loved.
I'm trying to be more real. I've been doing a lot of therapy and have a lot of breakthroughs, and I'm just saying how I feel now.
But 2 years ago, would you have admitted to the audience that you wanted to be loved?
I would have skated around it, but I knew I did.
Right. This is very interesting.
Yes, yes.
And I
revealing.
Think the comics, the great comics, are angry.
Oh, yeah.
Very and want to be loved.
Yes.
And they're like Citizen Kane. They want to be loved on their terms.
Yes, that's exactly right.
I had an experience this weekend where I realized I had a flashback to why my wife is it my ex-wife. Because I want love on my terms and my time is my time. And do not waste my time because if we're going to do this, that cuts into that.
Yep.
And I am prioritizing because I think comedians, when we're on stage, it teaches us, if you're a good comedian, you're a great comedian.
You're a good comedian.
Well, I'm okay. But, you know, it's like you cut through the BS.
Yeah, that's the plan.
And then in real life, it's like, cut it. No. What are you doing? What are you wasting my time?
Right.
Everything becomes the stage.
Yes.
And you start
doing things or talking to people, and you go, come on, come on, come on, pick up the pace, pick
right,
up the pace.
Right.
So it becomes impossible to go to parties
and yeah.
unless you're going, let's go, let's go, let's go. Do you find that's happening?
I do. You're right about the on my turn. Look at Dave Attell. He's killing. He goes, oh, you guys are all idiots. Fuck you. Come on. And then if he's not killing, he's like, where'd you go? What happened? Mm-hmm. You know, we want to still be assholes and still be loved.
Right.
And we want to be in control. It's like that Harry Shearer quote where he says, the only reason you do comedy is so you can control why people laugh at you. Because
wow.
if you walk in a room and everybody's going, look at this guy, you're like, oh, shit, what happened? But if you walk in a room and slip on purpose, then you were in control of it, you know?
Right.
You know,
right.
You slip on a banana peel, everybody laughs. But if you go tell people about a banana peel you slipped on, now you're in control of the laughs.
Do you find with anxiety, I find that my anxiety is cured by, like, editing or writing. Do you find, like, when you're... Do you have anxiety when you're on stage? I know you had, you know, anxiety doing Fallon, but when
yeah.
you're on stage.
I mean, about doing well, I want to do well. If I'm doing well, I'm just cool as a cucumber.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're like, oh, you know when you're just sharp and you know, oh, I know the next 13 moves I'm going to make.
Right.
That's a good feeling. But and the audience is with you, everything you say, they're hanging on your every word. That's great. No anxiety. That I feel better there than I do... You know, at a cocktail party.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the cocktail party is tough.
When's the last cocktail party you
went to? I mean, I go to house parties a lot, I guess I should say. Cocktail parties, crazy. Yeah. Who am I? You know, Howard Hughes? But, yeah, so when you're up there killing, I feel way better than I do at a restaurant with a bunch of people.
Do you ever get a 100% kill? Where you walk off and you go 100%, I could not do any better.
I've had that, but I've had that. The audience could say that was 100% kill, but I still know. Ah, that mm-hmm. line didn't get what I wanted, or that line's so old, and maybe that's a little hacky, and I shouldn't have done that. So there's always some critiquing with my own brain, but I feel like an audience could say that was 100% kill.
If you ask a pitcher to relive the game, they can tell you, like Nolan Ryan can tell you every pitch he threw.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, I believe it.
Can I walk you through a Fallon shot?
And you totally.
And you know
100%, yeah.
You can tell me exactly how the joke went?
Yep.
And what the response was?
Yep.
What about your special?
Probably, yeah.
Yeah.
It's an hour long, but I could do it.
What about a set at the Cellar, a 20-minute set at the Cellar?
If it was that night, yeah. I remember it back to front, but I do a lot of sets every night. I'm doing four tonight.
You do so many sets.
Oh, yeah.
Nobody works harder than you on the scene in New York. Nobody.
Yeah.
How many sets? I think I asked you this last time you were on the show. Did you set the record for most sets in one night?
I'm sure I did in New York, yeah.
How many sets did you do in one night?
I think I did that year. I think Dave Attell has it.
I think Aaron Berg has it.
Oh, Aaron Berg, yeah. What is he, at 11 or something?
He did, yeah. He did it like for a documentary. They specifically did the most anyone had done, and that was like less than a year ago.
Yeah.
How many sets did you do?
I just do like five a night or four a night. So I think I might have it over the year, but he has it like the most in a night.
And you're doing quality rooms, too.
Yeah, you know, I'll do any room. I'll do a bar. I'll do a warehouse, whatever.
That's the frustration living in L.A. I remember coming to New York. And I'm not making this up. In 3 days in New York, you can do a month's worth of work on stand-up.
No doubt about it.
If you really focus and you're trying to hone a seven-minute set, you can get it done in 3 days in New York.
3 days. A year in New York is 5 years in Cleveland.
So this is your first one-hour special.
Oh, yeah.
Are you already thinking about your next special?
Oh, of course. I've already got about 20 minutes.
You got 20... Your generation is different than mine.
It's a problem. It's not good.
No, it's good.
I think it's hurting comedy a little.
No, well, I was going to get... Well, let me give you the upside of it and let me pretend to be positive because it makes me look good.
All right.
Deep down, I'm seething. No, I think it's really interesting because we were thinking about the five-minute sets, you know, get on the Tonight Show.
Sure.
Get on the, you know, You guys are like musicians. I think it's so much. I'm being serious. So this is not fake. I think
it's like albums.
It's like albums.
Right. I never thought of it like that. I like that.
Yeah, we're not making singles. We're making albums.
Yeah.
And the audience is there for it.
Right. That's true. It's all different now because an audience wants comedy. They want content.
They want content. They want comedy, and they're willing to put in the time.
Oh yeah. I mean, it's crazy. You go on these message boards, they're all talking about the special. It just came out 3 days ago, and they're dissecting it, and they're, what is that joke in a reference to? And they know everything. They listen to all the podcasts. Like, I had a podcast where I talked about having sex with a celebrity, and they figured out who the celebrity was. I never gave a name, never gave a what she looked like or whatever, and they figured it out. Because these people, they get together. And
did you tell them they were right?
Oh, they knew, I think, because they put it together, and then she called me and chewed me out.
Did you chew her out?
No, she was right.
No, I'm talking about when you were having sex.
Yes. I wasn't less chewing, but more licking, but yeah.
Wow. It's a different experience.
Yeah.
There's a connection with the fans. What percentage of your day is spent interacting with your fans?
Probably too much, because I feel guilt. See, again, the guilt. I feel guilty and weird. Like, who am I? So if they take the time to write to me, I'm going to take the time back.
And it's mostly email?
No, it's mostly tweets and Facebook and stuff.
Okay, that's effortless, right?
Yeah, I just give it a favorite and go, thanks, or whatever. I write on the Instagram, hey, I appreciate it, something like that.
Do some fans creep you out?
I get so much gay love, like you wouldn't believe. Gay guy, I wish women liked me as much as gay guys. And I mean, it's like, I want to suck your balls, I'll lick your asshole till it's dry, you fucking bah, 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 bah. So you start to understand, like, oh, I get why women are freaked out all the time.
Yeah. By you?
Well, by any guy, because we come at it hard. Like, hey, this guy's like, I want you to blow a load in my face and sing me happy birthday. I'm like, all right, shit, how'd we get here?
Really, it's a service weird gay men give, that they let straight men understand what they're doing to women.
Yeah, there you go. That's true.
Do gay men think you're gay?
I don't think so. I mean, I have my whole act about trying to get laid and fucking puss and loving gash and chasing trim.
So maybe gay men look at you the way women look at gay men. You're the safe guy.
Yeah, maybe.
Maybe you're the guy who gay men want to go out with in case somebody doesn't want to dance.
Exactamundo.
Let's go, you know, I want to go to a bar.
Yeah.
But I want to hang out with somebody who's just going to sit with me instead of dancing all.
Yes.
Do you dance? Do you take women to clubs and dance?
No.
Have you ever taken a woman to a club and danced?
No. I've met women at clubs, but I've never taken a woman to a club.
What is that sound?
That is your phone.
It's Hollywood calling.
Oh, great. You're in.
I'm in.
Yeah, you got it.
Have you ever gone dancing with a woman?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, dancing.
When's the last time
you
went dancing with a woman?
I don't know. I met a girl at a dance club, and she said, you want to dance? And I said, sure. I won't turn down a
dance.
Do you
go to dance clubs?
No, I went in Amsterdam. I was in Amsterdam, and I got on Tinder to try to get laid, and this girl said, I'm at a dance club right now. And I said, I'm on my way, and ended up having sex.
Do you do comedy because you don't dance? I mean, to me, it's like a waste of time to go dancing.
I hate dancing.
I'm already a stripper. What do you need to go, right? What do I need to go dancing for?
Yeah.
If I want to move my body,
right.
I'll fuck you.
Yeah, exactly. What is the moving your body to music? And it's never good, and you feel stupid, and it's a waste of time. Women love to go dancing. I'm like, I'll watch you dance. It's hot. But what am I going to sit, stand behind you and jiggle?
Supposed somebody's videotaping us.
I know.
I mean, that's so humiliating. I mean,
really
you go to
is.
Weddings and you go to bar mitzvahs and sweet 16 parties.
Right.
And people, you have people moving their bodies. I guess it's kind of like comedy. You're making an asshole out of yourself. The whole point of dancing is to make an asshole out of yourself. But I've already made an asshole out of myself.
Well, some people are great at it and they're not making it. You're like, wow, I wish I could do that.
Women love men who can dance, which I think makes up for the whole 78 cents in the dollar thing.
And that goes back to the, you know, 19th century, 18th. Dancing, there's a courtship.
It's a connection.
And it's safe.
Yeah, it's safe.
You get to touch their hands.
And
you
it's fun.
And I guess women like it because it's testing your manners. That if you're willing to hold a woman but not grope, how does he, right? I guess.
Well, I think it's more of a let loose thing. Like, look, he's letting loose and he can be vulnerable and move with the music. I think it's more of that.
I think they're testing your physical prowess.
But I also think they're testing your civility because women want civility in a relationship. If you go back 300 years, it was very mannered. I'm going to put my arm around you, but I'm only going to touch you here, and I'm going to respect you. Now, there's, you know, there's no respect.
Yeah, but they can also read now. I mean, we also allow them to read and own property, so there is a trade-off.
True. I'm still.
What's the longest Mark Norman has ever gone without sex?
Oh my God! I mean, years, high school, and all that.
You play the long game with women?
No, I hate the long game. I think it's.
You
silly.
Told me the long game was good. That there were women who. This was 2 years ago.
I mean, I'll do the long game as in plant a seed, then come back every now and then. But I'm not doing the whole like, let's take you out again, then we'll go out again, then we'll talk on the phone, then we'll go out again. And, you know, like that's silly to me.
Do you think you could ever settle down?
I think I could. I don't know. It seems odd. The whole thing seems off and unnatural. Doesn't it? It never works. You know, if someone is together for 30 years, we literally applaud them. Because, wow, you did it. You get applauded for joining the military and for staying together. That's insane. You got shot at, and you almost got shot at by your wife. Yeah. That's how hard it is. We compare it with fighting in a war.
You don't think there's one soulmate out there for Mark Norman?
No, I don't.
Soulmate's is there a silly. Woman you're haunted by?
No.
No woman. Is there a woman?
I'm dying to meet her.
I would say you've had sex. You're 33. I would suspect you've had sex with more than 4 women.
Yes.
Okay.
Today.
What's the most in one day?
Three in a day.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Oysters?
I remember the day.
Vitamin E?
No. Just good old-fashioned desperation.
Okay, wait. How many in one day?
Three.
Three? With the three different women?
Three different women. But it's mapped out pretty cleverly.
Yeah, I got to hear this.
All right. I had sex with a girl after midnight one night.
That doesn't count.
All right, well, this is technically
okay,
24
ahead.
Hours.
It's 24 hours.
Yeah, we
fell
asleep.
How many sets did you do that day?
I think I did 3 sets. Fucked a girl at, you know, 1 in the morning,
where?
Passed out
at
her apartment.
Right, slow down, young man. This is the most important thing I need to hear.
All right.
Okay, so you did a set.
Yes.
Where'd you perform?
I'm sure it was a Comedy Cellar or a club. Or, you know.
Did you meet the woman at the club?
I met the girl after the show. I
How was
had
your
plans
set?
With her.
How was your? Oh, you met her after the show. Did she see you perform?
Yes. I brought her to the last show I had. She saw me perform.
How'd you do?
I did well.
Did you kill?
I had a kill. We had a few drinks, went back to her place, had sex. She went to work at 9 in the morning, as civilians do. I went home, had a girl meet me at my house at about, I don't know, 3 or
three
something.
In the afternoon.
3 in the afternoon.
How did you hook up with her? Was it through Tinder?
No, she was like, it was like a, I don't want to say a comedian, but she's in the business. So we'd always kind of like, hey, whenever you're, we should meet
okay.
up.
Okay, had you ever had sex with this woman?
No.
Before? The woman who you spent the night with, had you had sex with her before?
No.
Okay, so this is, the first one was new.
Mm-hmm.
The second one was?
I knew her, but I never had sex with her.
And you had sex with her?
I had sex with her about 3 in the afternoon.
You had sex at 3 in the afternoon at your apartment. Did you shower before?
I did, yeah.
So you had cleaned off the other woman.
Yes.
Did you feel any guilt?
No. I mean, none of this was a relationship. This was all good times.
Do you think the second woman would be upset if she found out that you had sex 12 hours earlier?
Probably. Especially since it was less than 12 hours.
Uh-huh.
No, I guess it was about 12 hours, yeah.
Okay.
So then I did a show later that night and had sex with a girl like, you know, 10 at night.
Okay, that's doable. And so how did you meet the woman for the
third woman I knew already had sex with. She worked for Goldman Sachs. She had a great apartment downtown.
Mm-hmm.
Unbelievable.
And did you say, I've got the hat trick?
Yeah, I remember.
Were you going for the hat trick?
I was going for the hat trick. Because hanging out with this girl was a nightmare, but I just went for it for the hat trick.
Did you lower your standards?
No, I knew her. I'd had sex with her many a time. But I was just going for the 3.
You're going for the 3. So let's review. The first one saw you perform.
Yes.
Who I'm going to say, and you had a lot of drinks. A
couple drinks, yeah.
I'm going to say you don't remember that.
No, I remember it. I had like 2 scotches.
Okay. Who was the best? Let me try to predict.
Okay.
The one you miss, the one that you sometimes get a chubby thinking about. I'm going to say the afternoon sex.
You got it. You're right.
I was going to say I'm pretty sure it's the one he still has to see. he still has communicate with is going to be the best one.
Yeah, the afternoon was the best one.
Okay, hang on, let's try to figure this out. The afternoon was the best one. Is it because of her or because of the timing?
She was the hottest, and it was just something hot about the middle of the day, just coming over. And I already had the other one, and she didn't know about that, so that was fun. So I don't know.
So there's a thrill to
it was a thrill to that, and I'd already slept. I'd got a good night's sleep. The third one's kind of the end of the night when I'd done a few shows and already got laid once. So the third one's just kind of like, let's do this for the story. And the first one was like, oh, cool, we're getting laid. And the second one's like, oh, we're fucking a girl in the middle of the day.
You know? Right.
So it was the second one was the funnest.
And the third one, because she works for Goldman Sachs, you couldn't care less about her.
Well, she was just annoying and...
a horrible human being.
Yeah, she was...
She works for Goldman Sachs.
I guess so. She was like a dumb blonde and she was a shoo-in.
Yeah. Did she want to be treated like crap? Because she works for Goldman Sachs? Did she know that she's scum?
She kind of did like that, yeah. She was a nice person. She's a good person. I don't know
But she works for Goldman Sachs.
Yeah, does that make you bad?
Yes.
Why?
Because Goldman Sachs doesn't provide a service. They transfer money from you to them. They're thieves. As
oh,
Bernie
really?
Sanders says.
To be fair, she's a cleaning lady. I don't think she's
right.
Responsible.
All right, and let's see. Let me guess. The first sexual encounter, you had sex with her again or
no,
not?
No,
no. The second one you did.
Yep.
And the third one, the Goldman Sachs, let me predict. The Goldman Sachs woman, you walked out thinking, never again, but you've had sex with her again.
Well done. Nailed
really?
It. Nailed it, yeah.
Are you?
It took like 6 months later, but I went back.
You went back because she wanted in.
Yeah. And I was like, yeah, why not?
God, you're my hero.
That is exactly what I would
I wish
guess
I could
too.
Be this guy.
Well
I wish
done.
I could be
Good
you.
Guess.
I wish I could be you. So let me ask you a question.
You could do it. You could do it.
Do women want to be treated with respect? I have this theory that I would be a much happier man if I didn't worship women.
Mm.
That
I think you're right. Yeah. You're
my knees
happier.
Buckle around women and I'm like their slave. I'm a, you know, just mm. I, and
they're buckling too, though.
Well, no, but I'm like, it's gotten to the point where I'm like, hang out with my mother and my sister. That's how desperate
what?
I am. Well, the sex. No, just female company. But if you don't, so do you think it's easier to get laid? Right after you got laid. Is there something, is there a
yeah,
scent?
I think
is
so.
Is there a confidence?
It's a confidence. It's a lack of need. It's a lack of desperation. It's an ease about you.
Really?
I think so,
and the
yeah.
women pick up on it.
Oh, yeah. Women are picking, they're so intuitive. They're amazing creatures.
Do they smell another woman on you?
Maybe, but that I would never know. I mean, that's some olfactory bullshit. Yeah, it's the compliment.
See, what
confidence.
I don't understand about women is... If I find out, as a guy, if we find out that there's a woman who can be passed around, I don't want in.
Mm-hmm.
I go, ah, yeah. That's not. But I've been told that if women sense a guy is a great lover,
mm-hmm.
they don't mind that he's a, as they say, a coxman.
Yeah, I mean, I think...
I mean, you have a reputation. Do
yes.
you mind if I tell you that?
No, I'm fine with it.
Okay, so you have a reputation.
I'm aware.
And you're a swordsman, as
sure.
they say. Women are attracted to that.
I think they are, subconsciously. They'll shit on you all day and talk about this and that and say he's a scum, he's a pig, whatever. But I think deep down, I think when even like Tiger Woods, a guy like that, when he cheats, I think on a small level in a woman's brain, they're going, well, of course he's cheating. Good for him. Not good for him, but I think there's a little bit like, that's kind of hot. He's a man. He's going after what he wants.
And do they think, well, he's a great lover, so he would know how to make me come?
I think that's in there, yeah.
Or do they want something else?
Yes.
Maybe there's they want the pin you down kind of thing. You know,
they want like, the competition.
They want the competition.
Women are more attracted to someone who they know other women want. So women want to be with someone who sleeps around simply because they want to show all those other women he had sex with, I'm as good or better than you because he had sex with me.
I'm so glad that a woman is not here to set us straight.
I know. Well, they would lie. They would lie.
Okay, so the women want a guy who sleeps around. And do they care about the orgasm? Do they care about being worshipped?
That comes later.
Really?
I don't think they're sitting there going, orgasm, orgasm. I think they're in the bedroom.
Thinking about the other women.
Yeah.
It's a sense of competition.
And so they're like landing somebody. I got this guy.
I got this. That's what I'm saying. They want to pin you down. I got him. I saddled this horse.
That's pleasurable for them?
Well, it's in there. It's innate.
Even if they don't come.
Stop worrying about the coming.
Not every woman needs to come.
Yeah, it's about the conquer.
They're conquering us.
Yeah.
They're conquering every woman you've had sex with before.
Yes.
What? Yeah, I really think that.
You think that or do you know that?
Well, no one knows anything.
No one knows anything.
But do you know that?
I think that as well, and they will not admit it, but they know it.
And then they have sex with you to be able to report back to their friends?
It's not for them. It's for their own selves. It's not for the friends.
So their self-worth is...
I don't know about worth, but it's competition. It's a ego boost.
All right. We got to... You'll come back?
Yeah, but there's a lot of women are listening right now going, I hate these fucking guys.
All right. Boy, this was fun.
This was fun. We got somewhere good, I feel like. Somewhere deep.
Let me ask you one final question.
All righty.
Who's your favorite comic?
Oh, probably Groucho. Yeah, big fan. He's probably the basis for my whole shtick. He's the template.
And what should we watch?
I'd say Duck Soup's pretty good. There's also on YouTube, there's a lot of compilations of like his best You Bet Your Life moments and stuff like that. So I would check that out.
Well, we just scratched the surface. This was great.
This was great.
And I know, I don't mean to embarrass you,
but
your fly is open and you got a booger in your nose.
No, oh, shit.
I know how busy you are, and you have this new Comedy Central special.
Uh-huh. Thank you.
That everybody...
Available on Netflix.
That will be on Netflix.
Yeah.
Because everything will be at some point.
Hopefully, it'll get on there.
Amy Schumer presents Mark Norman, Don't Be Yourself.
That's the one.
A great comedian... And I hope you come back ASAP. Thank you, sir.
I'd love to come back. I love it here. And love you guys. And thanks for having me. And praise Allah.